Despite uprisings across the Arab world, one country has remained immune, or so it seems, to challenges to its autocratic rule. 10 days ago, we reported from Saudi Arabia on the so-called Day of Rage, when only a single demonstrator dared to turn up. The tens of thousands who claimed to support the day were put off by the show of force, by the cash handouts from the king, and by the deep conservatism that underlies Saudi society. Nowhere is that felt more strongly than among the women of Saudi Arabia. Indeed, one describes her country as the biggest women's prison in the world. Sue Lloyd-Roberts has been there.
Quite nice. Lots and lots of black.
The first stop for a woman planning to spend any time in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia is to get herself an abaya.
Are there different sizes?
The all-black covering, without which she can't leave the house without a severe reprimand and even the threat of a lashing from the morality police. The formidably named Committee for the Protection of Virtue and Prevention of Vice. Along the rows of black robes, I was looking for something, well, different.
Are you really allowed to wear salmon pink in Saudi Arabia, or is this for bedrooms only?
I settled for about as daring as I could go, an abaya in naughty navy and bewitching brown.
You're allowed to go around in brown and black?
And then in a country where a Saudi man can't even look on, let alone touch, an unrelated woman, came one of those bizarre contradictions you find time and again here. It was the shop assistant himself who added the final touch.
I'm ready now for reporting Saudi Arabia.
I was now ready to join the black shadows who make up half the population of this country and to do what they do of an evening, go to the shopping mall.
Cooped up in the house all day, only able to get out when there's a driver available, a night at the shopping mall is about as good as it gets for the majority of women here in Saudi Arabia. And so a newcomer like myself can be forgiven for wondering whether, if a revolution were to start in this country, it could well begin with the women.
Reem Assad has started a revolt of kinds. A university lecturer in finance, she's rebelling against the fact that it is only men who can serve in shops, albeit mainly South Asian, to spare the Saudi man from any contact with a woman to whom he's not related. But how does she cope when buying a bra? Men serving in lingerie shops are the main target of Reem's campaign. Our male cameraman was stopped by the male shop assistant from following us in. Though when I asked him to find me a bra, he had no inhibitions.
I'd like to buy a bra.
Okay.
So could you find someone to measure me?
I will help you.
You will help me.
Do I find it embarrassing to have to check out the items at the cashier with the teller or the clerk being a male? Yes, I do. The other component to my campaign is creating more employment opportunities for women. Women rightfully need to be in the right place, and what better could be than a lingerie shop?
Reem's campaign might appear frivolous in a country where there are more urgent problems. Polygamy and underage marriage prevail. But she argues her campaign tackles major irritants for Saudi women, like lack of dignity and jobs.
You're listening to Mix FM.
If Reem's campaign is a shopping rebellion, Mix FM is a workplace revolution. Up until a few years ago, women weren't allowed to work alongside men. But now an exception has been made in TV news studios and radio chat shows. For the tens of thousands of girls who graduate every year and whose only career option had been teaching, it's a huge breakthrough. Dina is a kind of agony aunt for the station. The most frequent complaint from teenagers is boredom.
What about an 18-year-old girl who says, look, I just want to meet men of my age without my family around?
That's kind of a little bit of a problem that we have over here, but hopefully it's part of the culture.
So sometimes some of the culture things that we have, we cannot really change, but we can actually let them accept it.
She knows she has to tread carefully. Women aren't allowed to work in Saudi Arabia without permission of their male guardians, their fathers or husbands. An inappropriate word could close the station down. Dina may be a revolutionary, but like all women in Saudi Arabia, she's not allowed to drive, and after work has to wait for her brother to come and collect her. There is no urban public transport system here. Thousands of women don't work simply because they can't get to work.
It was 21 years ago that 47 women, all of whom had been educated abroad and held international driving licenses, drove through the center of Riyadh. We tried to contact some of them to ask them what they were feeling about it today, but they're all reluctant to talk. They faced a barrage of criticism after the incident from as many women as men.
The criticism came from women like Rauda, seen here in one of her frequent TV appearances. She's launched a campaign entitled, My Guardian Knows What's Best for Me, for which she's won fame and praise from the country's religious conservatives. But it's okay for her with her family money and her own personal driver. What about the many women who can't work because they can't drive?
90% of Saudi society have up until now refused to condone women driving. The problem is not me or you or a group of educated women wanting for a Saudi woman to drive. The woman that you mentioned who isn't able to go out to work because she can't drive, how would she have the means to buy a car?
I was getting weary of these privileged women with their money, their drivers and their crazy logic. There must be real women out there somewhere with real problems. We drove into the poorer areas of Jeddah to meet up with Fadwa, a volunteer social worker. She took me on a tour of women who, because they don't have male guardians, have no official identity.
She needs treatment. She has high blood pressure. She's diabetic. She hasn't got enough money to pay her rent, electricity, water, or transport to hospital.
But her main problem is that she's a widow. She doesn't have a man to go to all the relevant offices to ask for help. And there were many like her begging Fadwa to intervene for them. Like this woman of ethnic Yemeni origin, who's divorced and gets no support from her ex-husband. Although she and all eight children were born in Saudi Arabia, they're not considered Saudi.
A divorced woman or widow is ashamed to go and ask for help. This is the problem. They know the government should help, but they do not go and ask.
I asked Fadwa what she would do if she were Minister of Welfare.
If I were in a position of power, I would show how a woman can listen and understand a woman's issues better. I would get rid of all the bureaucracy. People wait months to get help. We need a way to make things faster. There should be a computerized system where people's needs can be registered. That's what I would do.
But Fadwa is unlikely to be made Minister of Welfare. She's a woman.
I met many angry women in Saudi Arabia, though few were prepared to be filmed, like the author of this Saudi woman's blog. She's in her 30s and she says that she and her friends are fed up with being treated like children. She wouldn't let us film her, but we did record her voice.
Before, you never knew if there were people who thought like you. If anything, anything comes out of this revolution, uprising across the Middle East, it's that Saudis are becoming much more aware of their human rights and questioning authority and questioning the religious establishment and demanding answers.
Those who hold power in the country are resistant. Here, a group of tribal leaders pray before debating the affairs and the needs of the local community. Why are there no women among them? After all, they make up 50% of the population.
And they should have a voice in decision-making.
They have a voice. Their home, their house, their children. They have responsibilities to their children to raise them, to look after them. Here in Saudi Arabia, for example, it is not like in other countries. Here, the man is supposed to support the family. Because here, I mean, most of the women know what they are supposed to do. If I don't feel that there is someone taking care of my house, how can I work?
I found a lot of support for these views in the country. No wonder Rauda claims that the majority of Saudis back her campaign.
I have won two of the three sectors of society onto my side. I have won the moderates, who are the majority, and the conservatives. It's just the liberals who don't agree, and I don't know what they want. Do they just expect a woman to live without a man? Any so-called liberal I've spoken to has left his wife at home, and it's only other women he wants to liberate. The Jeddah chapter of the Saudi Harley Davidson Club out for a ride. To my astonishment, they took me along. That's me attempting a wave. Their action broke all the rules which govern Saudi society. Surely, I thought, such dashing, risk-taking young men would sympathize with the fate of the Saudi woman. Why are their wives not with them? Don't they have the right to enjoy themselves?
As a human rights, yes, women is equal to men in this country, but there is some cultural difficulties. Women, they don't drive here, but they go everywhere with a chauffeur, you know. I bet you would prefer that in your country, maybe.
Just because we say that a woman should stay at home, it doesn't mean that we're not giving her her rights. A woman can sit at home, she can eat, she can drink, she's comfortable, and everything comes to her. In our religion, men are responsible for women. My mum, my sister, my wife, they can stay at home and I'll take care of them. In our religion, women obey their men. If my wife wants to work, she can work, but only with my permission. And I won't be forced.
I can only conclude that it is the innate conservatism, respect for culture and tradition, and fear in the kingdom that prevent women here from joining the 21st century. So long as women are kept out of the public eye, totally dependent on their fathers and husbands, unable to complain openly, and away from all decision-making, it's likely to remain that way. At the bottom tier of society, the most a mother can aspire to for her two daughters, who are in their 20s and who've seldom been out of the house since finishing primary school, is, she says, for them to find male guardians.
All I want for them is to get married, to find good husbands who will let them continue their education. I don't want them to have a life like mine.
While at the top, no one's taking bets on imminent change.
Will this ever end? And if so, will this be in our lifetime? I certainly want to see things change before my daughters have to grow up and face the same difficulties that we face.
A woman I met here described Saudi Arabia as the biggest woman's prison in the world. Reem, not yet 40, has given up. She can only hope that her daughter's generation might be the first to demand change and break free.
Sue Lloyd-Roberts there. Well, joining me now is Ayan Hirsi Ali, former Muslim who's received death threats for her defiance of Islam, whose new book, Nomad, A Personal Journey Through the Clash of Civilizations, calls on the West to be less tolerant of the faith. Ayan, thanks very much for coming in. A lot of our viewers will watch this and say, actually, that's not representative of Islam. That's about deep cultural conservatism. That's what it is.
Well, there's the good news and there's the bad news. And the good news is societies like this one, like Saudi Arabia, are opening. The women we had just now are Saudis coming out and speaking out. I listened 2 weeks ago to women from Egypt, from Somalia, from Iran, from all over the place, all coming out. This is different from when I started speaking out in 2001, 2002, and I thought I was a lone voice. And the good news is we're all out there now, and we're exposing it, hanging out the dirty laundry. The bad news is after the denial and the defense and the defensive attitude, we are going to face obstacles, and part of it is going to be violent.
But my point is that you're putting all this together as a condemnation of Islam itself. It's not Islam. It's particular varieties of how the religion's expressed in places like Saudi and Somalia and Yemen. It's not the Islam of Indonesia, which has, what, four times as many women as those countries put together.
Well, I wish it was not Islam. I wish Indonesia was different. I wish Turkey was different. I wish Malaysia was different. And the Islam practice there was different. And what you see is in the 1960s.
You don't think the Islam of Malaysia or of Turkey is different to the Islam of Saudi Arabia?
In the 1950s, 60s, 70s, Muslims in Indonesia, in Egypt, in Pakistan had a completely different attitude toward modernity and especially toward women. You now compare it to life in these places and you see, in the name of Islam, the rights of women being taken away. And that is done through the establishment and spread of Sharia law or Islamic law. In some places, it's less severe. In some places, it's more severe. But at the core of it, the argument that those people who take our rights away, the argument they make is in the name of Islam. And to say to the people who try and separate religion from culture, a reminder, Islam was not founded in Italy or in the US or here in the UK. It was founded in an Arab and desert culture. And a great deal of that culture, that dynamic of shame and honor, has been elevated to what is religion, what has now become Islam.
What do you say to these incredibly powerful Muslim women who embrace their religion and their right to speak out, to lead countries? What do you say to the protesters in Tahrir Square who say, I can embrace Western democratic ideals and fight for them and still adhere to the tenets of Islam?
I say, let's go on and let's unite under an umbrella for freedom and change. 2 weeks ago, Tina Brown, a British national who's become an American citizen, put together this amazing conference. And she had an Egyptian woman who was protesting in Tahrir Square. And that woman and all the other young women she mobilized, 25 years old, she said, as soon as Mubarak was gone, the men told us to go home. And they were not included in the formation of, you know, the constitution or the referendum.
But then that's about education, isn't it? I mean, a lot of your book actually talks about the difference. You and your father, sort of curiously ambivalent in his attitudes towards women, giving you an education. Isn't that what it comes down to?
Woman and all those young women on Tahrir Square were not talking to my father or my traumatic past. The men who excluded them for the freedom that they demonstrated for said that it was in the name of the Quran, the Prophet Muhammad, and in the name of Islam. What I found interesting about that young woman was that she said, I am a Muslim, but I do not want a society based on Sharia. And it's that separation that we need, women and men in the Middle East who are serious about the aspiration for freedom, is to say, fine, it's not a condemnation of the religion, but let's separate religion from politics. By doing so, we're going to save the face of Islam and
But you call Islam a fatally flawed faith, one that you say you hope you won't pass on. I mean, Don't you have a worry internally that you're going to fuel a lot of religious bigotry from this kind of talk? It's the kind of talk that certainly wouldn't be tolerated from the far right.
Well, I look at the bigotry that is used by a father to force his nine-year-old into marriage and invoke the practice of the Prophet Muhammad. And in that, then I choose to say, well, there is the potential bigotry of white supremacists, potential, that has been dealt with, talked about, and really tamed. And then there's this huge bigotry that is used by men in the Middle East, inspired by Islam, spread in the name of Islam, to rob masses and masses of women of their rights on a daily basis. And my priority is then to say, let's separate that religion. I'm not for the abolition of Islam. I just want to separate Sharia law and Islam from politics and the right and human rights.
Why do you think we don't hear more about that then from the West? I mean, our politicians are very cautious to make the distinction between Islam and Islamism, the politicization.
We hear it sometimes. I think that your Prime Minister, David Cameron, made a fantastic speech in Munich where he did say, look, we are not going to cover up for this anymore. It's not just violent extremism, it's also non-violent extremism spread in the name of Islam. Angela Merkel, Chancellor in Germany, did the same. Sarkozy is doing the same. So in Europe, there are more and more voices from the top leadership who are saying this whole business of multiculturalism is something that has to go. And I think that it becomes even more urgent as more and more Muslims
flow into. Just taking you back very briefly to the film, are you confident that this could change in our lifetime? Because, you know, Saudi Arabia is a big ally of the West, right? It's presumably got to change from within. It's not our attitudes.
Well, things will change in Saudi Arabia as more and more women who are allowed to go to school challenge their situation and say, this is not what we want. And right now, the change you see, the video that we've seen, is very gentle in a way. But there are forces within Saudi Arabia led by men, human rights activists, and by women, and by homosexuals. And that change could come in a very violent way. So it's gentle and I support it.
Okay.
But there is no. When we talk about Europe and the UK, it's a change in the reverse that we see. And that's the one that we have to be careful about.
Ayaan Hirsi, I'm so sorry to end it, but thank you very much indeed for coming in. Thank you.
Thank you.